All right, the time is upon us. Welcome to the University of Montana's Physics and Astronomy Department seminar series. This week we have another one of our own speaking. Senior Morgan Jimmy Henderson is joining us today to talk about some work that he did over the summer. Jimmy came to us from just down the Bitterroot at Corvallis High School. You first visited the University of Montana Physics Department as a member of Corvallis High School. You came up in Jaylene's annual Corvallis High School visit, and that's been a real pipeline for us. We have a number of students that are graduates of Corvallis that came here first through that interaction. Jimmy joined us, this is your fourth year here, and is it really your fifth? Okay, fifth year here. Jimmy took the relativity course, Physics 141, from me, and I immediately pulled him into the Minerva orbit. So he's been working on Minerva for about 3 years now. And through his work with Minerva, he is a published author. He has an Astrophysical Journal article on microlensing detection of exoplanets. That's a pretty cool thing to do as an undergraduate. In addition to that, Jimmy got a summer RU at SETI, the Search for Extraterrestrial Intelligence, program that was operated, in his case, at NASA's facility in Ames in the Bay Area, where he lived for the summer with a security clearance badge. Pretty cool stuff. And so Jimmy today is going to be talking about his work from SETI. After today's talk, he'll finish up his coursework and graduate and leave us in May and on to bigger and better things, including getting married this summer. With no more ado for Jimmy here, I'm going to turn him over. He's going to talk about carbon monoxide emissions in middle-aged debris disks, the work he did at SETI. Jimmy?
Sure. Good afternoon, everybody. Thank you for being here. As you've all heard now, my name is Morgan, or Jimmy Henderson, and today I will be talking to you about carbon monoxide emissions in middle-aged debris disks. However, before I jump right in, I'd like to take you through a roadmap that we will return to periodically throughout the talk, just so that you know sort of where things are headed. First off, I would like to give you a brief introduction to debris disks, as I'm sure many of you in the audience are unfamiliar with the term. I will then discuss the observations that provided the impetus for my research and provide you with the two primary theories as to the origins of gas in debris disks. I will then finally get around to talking about what I actually did last summer in modeling these disks and provide you with the results from my work and try to make some conclusions and have a brief discussion about these results. But first thing is first, and I owe you an introduction to debris disks. So what are debris disks? Well, debris disks are circumstellar disks that are greater than 10 million years in age. If you're unfamiliar with what circumstellar disks are, they're basically just disks of material that form around young stars, basically left over from giant clouds of molecules that stars form from, and they collapse into disks due to the conservation of angular momentum. The debris disks themselves, as with everything else in the universe, age with time, and as they age, they develop and they evolve. And the main effect of evolution in these disks is that they lose material. So the material in the disks is either accreted onto the host star, is used up in the formation of icy, gaseous, and rocky bodies, or is blown out of the disk entirely by stellar radiation. However, collisions between rocky bodies in the disks are continuously replenishing the dust populations in the disk. So what you get is the secondary population of dust, which is actually optically thin, so these disks are still observationally distinguishable from younger, what we call primordial disks. However, these collisions have not previously been thought to be substantial producers of gas within the disks, and so what you expect over time is that these disks become optically thin in their dust, and that they generally lose their gas populations, they become gas poor. So if you look to the top left-hand side of the screen here, what you see is a figure of the fraction of stars within a population that host debris disks as a function of age. And what you'll notice is that by 10, certainly by 15 or 20 million years, what you see is that very few stars in any given population will actually host disks. If you look to the bottom plot, what you're looking at is a plot of the surface density of gas in these disks as a function of age, and the age goes from about 10 million years to about 1 billion years. And actually what you're seeing is the failure of these researchers to make a significant detection of gas in any of these disks. So just as we would expect due to the theoretical physics on the subject, you do not see gas in most of these disks. Now here's just another plot that I've included for you from a paper by Wyatt et al. In 2014, and what this is showing is the dust mass in disks around stars as a function of age. So if you look to quadrant one, what we have are young stars, younger than 10 million years old, that host disks of greater than a single Earth mass in dust. Quadrant 2, then, is of course just the young stars that already do not host more than a single Earth mass of dust in their disks. Quadrant 3, which is where the stars that were the focus of my research would be located, are older stars, stars greater than 10 million years old, that host less than a single Earth mass in their dust. And quadrant 4 would represent stars greater than 10 million years old that host dusty disks of greater than a single Earth mass. Now I say would represent because, as you may notice, the fourth quadrant here is conspicuously empty. And that's because we just do not see these objects. We do not see stars hosting disks greater than a single Earth mass past the age of 10 million years, which leads us to believe that they simply don't exist. Now, to give you an idea of the scale of these objects, I've included here three spatially resolved images of the three disks that I worked with. And with each of them, I have included basically a mock solar system next to them that is scaled to the size of our solar system, with that outer ring being the orbit of Neptune at 30 AU. So these are rather large objects. They have inner radii anywhere from 40 to 80 AU, and they have outer radii anywhere from 140 to 160 AU, again, as compared with the orbit of Neptune, which is 30 AU astronomical units. So they are very large objects. So now that you've heard a little bit more about debris disks, I will talk to you about the observations that led to my research. The observations in question were taken at the Atacama Large Millimeter Array, or ALMA, which is located in the Atacama Desert in Chile, and it is pictured here to the bottom of the screen. What ALMA observed, at least for the purposes of my research, were actually emissions that come from carbon monoxide molecules. So carbon monoxide is actually a rotationally asymmetric molecule, which is to say that one side of the molecule is more massive than the other, which provides carbon monoxide with relatively low energy rotationally excited states. And so these states are actually populated generally through collisions with other molecules and other particles, not through the absorption of radiation, because again, they are very low energy states. And they generally produce radiation through de-excitation in the millimeter wavelength, making them a great candidate for ALMA observations. And the data that I worked with specifically come from the J equals 2 to 1 transition in carbon monoxide, which produces 1.3 millimeter wavelength light. Now, the nice thing about having these emissions to detect carbon monoxide in celestial objects is carbon monoxide is a great tracer of other types of gases, such as molecular hydrogen, which, for reasons that I won't get into during the length of my talk, are much more difficult to detect observationally. And so carbon monoxide sort of provides us with a way of tracking the gas populations in celestial objects, such as debris disks, when we don't have any other options for those observations. Now, as I said before in the previous slides, these debris disks that were the focus of my research, we don't expect to see gas emissions coming from them. So when you observe in this wavelength these stars around which these disks exist, you expect to get nothing, right? You expect to see no gas. So of course, it was surprising to researchers in the field when observations starting around 2012 from ALMA actually show significant detections of carbon monoxide emissions coming from several debris disks that are located specifically around A and F type stars. And here I will point out the three disks that I researched, HIP-73145 disk, the disk around HIP-76310, and the one around HIP-84881. So this sort of begs the question, you know, what gives? Where is this gas coming from? How is it getting into these disks? Why wasn't it used up or blown out of these disks millions of years ago? So to answer that question, I will provide you with the two currently prevailing theories as to the origin of gas in these disks. The first of these was put forth primarily by the earliest papers on the subject, which were written by the observational scientists that took the data, because of course they had the earliest access to the data. And by and large, what these papers come to the conclusion of is that the gas in these disks is primordial, which is to say that it is left over from star formation. For those of you in the know who are familiar with these terms, if you're not, don't worry, this isn't very crucial to my talk, but some of the papers actually propose that what we're witnessing is an intermediate stage between what are called T-Tauri stars and pre-main sequence stars with planetary debris disks. And of course, when we looked at these disks in the first place, what we expected to see were pre-main sequence stars with debris disks. However, these conclusions of this primordial gas actually would require that the gas in these disks has somehow persisted over abnormally long periods of time. And this persistence, of course, flies in the face of pretty fundamental physics, which would suggest that the gas is pushed out by radiation pressure or is accreted onto the star or, again, used up in the formation of bodies. However, there is no known mechanism that would allow this gas to be so resilient and to stay in these disks for such an extended period of time. And perhaps most importantly, there was no mechanism actually proposed by the authors of these papers to account for the resiliency of the gas in these disks. Now that is pretty irksome to theoretical scientists in the field because you can't really question fundamental physics in front of a theoretician. And my advisor, Dr. Uma Gordy, actually happens to be a theoretical scientist. And so my advisor and several other scientists in the field, including a small population of the observational scientists, actually favor what is called the collisional model of gas production in these disks. So as I said before, we know that collisions between rocky, icy, and gaseous bodies are occurring in these disks. However, we have not previously believed that they produce significant amounts of gas. Now, the reason that we don't believe that they produce significant amounts of gas is simply because in the past and historically when we've looked at these disks, we don't see gas. And so the very easy thing to say is, well, the collisions don't produce gas, but they do produce dust. However, with these new observations, and specifically from ALMA, which I should point out to those of you who aren't familiar with ALMA, it is actually the most sensitive millimeter wavelength instrument that we have at the disposal of mankind currently, so it is actually more sensitive to radiation. And so what the theoreticians in my field believe is that what we're seeing really is just the revealing of a selection bias, that we weren't seeing gas in disks before because we weren't sensitive enough before to detect this gas, and that now we have ALMA, it's much more sensitive, and we're seeing the gas, and it's worth noting that we see them specifically around more massive A and F type stars, the host disks, not around G and K type stars, so it could very well be that with greater sensitivity we would even see gas emissions coming from the disks around G and K type stars. So basically what happens in these disks when you have collisions between rocky bodies, which I've diagrammed cartoonishly here for you, is two cometary bodies collide and some of the mass involved in the collision is ejected in the form of a debris cloud, which we in the field refer to as a collisional cascade. Now in this collisional cascade, what you get is material moving at differential velocity, so you get material running into other material. So it's a very high kinetic energy, very dynamic environment in which you expect there to be a lot of collisions. You also get a lot of shearing, so larger chunks over time get sheared down into much smaller particles as this sort of dynamic environment comes to settle in the empty space around the around the star. However, this also means that the material in these collisional cascades is exposed to high energy radiation coming from the host stars, which means that carbon monoxide and other molecules in the debris cascades would be subject to this radiation, and thus would be potentially photodissociated, or in other words, torn apart by the high energy light coming in from the host star. So the question really is not, do these collisions produce a population of gas, because in these bodies we expect there to be carbon dioxide and carbon monoxide ices, so of course these collisional cascades would contain gas, but the question becomes, are they frequent enough, and do they produce enough gas to account for the observations that have been made? And many of the earliest work on the subject claims that no, they are not and they do not. And one paper in particular that I'll focus on for the course of the next couple of slides by Moore et al. 2013 actually came to the conclusion that you would have to produce on the order of 200 to 500 Earth masses of collisional material every single year in order to account for the observations that we see. If you're not familiar, the Earth is actually rather massive, and so 200 to 500 Earth masses of collisional material every year is a pretty extraordinary claim. However, these papers made some very fundamental assumptions, and these assumptions may not have been the safest assumptions. One of the first ones that I like to address is that all UV radiation photodissociates carbon monoxide. Now, the researchers defined UV radiation as starting at 9 electron volts and higher. However, it has been shown in laboratory settings that carbon monoxide is not photodissociated by energy, by photon light, until it gets to about 11.6 electron volts. So if you look to the effective black body curve for one of the host stars of the disks that I was studying, you will notice that the amount of flux or the amount of light per unit time that you're receiving at 9 electron volt energies is significantly greater than 11.6 electron volt energies, especially when you consider the fact that what you're doing is integrating up from that point through the end of the high energy tail to determine how much light the star is producing per unit time that could eventually potentially destroy these molecules. So when they overestimate the amount of photodissociative light coming out of the star, per unit time, what you would do is you would then underestimate the average lifetime of carbon monoxide molecules in these debris cascades. And when you overestimate or underestimate the amount of time that these molecules are surviving, you also then overestimate the amount of gas you would have to produce per unit time in order to produce the equilibrium masses that would give us the observations that we observe. Another key assumption in these papers is that the relative abundance between our emitter, carbon monoxide, and the collider, the primary collider that excites that populates the excited state molecular hydrogen, is equal to the relative abundance seen in the interstellar medium, the space between stars. This abundance is about 1 in 10,000. Now on the nose, this doesn't seem like such a ridiculous assumption. After all, we make it in many places in astrophysics. However, when you think about the environment that we're suggesting here, it is pretty clear that maybe this is not the safest assumption to make. Because ultimately, the source of the carbon monoxide and the source of the molecular hydrogen that is populating the excited state in the carbon monoxide is not the interstellar medium, but our cometary bodies and the debris disks. So a much safer assumption to make would be a relative abundance of what you would expect inside a cometary body, which is not necessarily equal to what you would see in the interstellar medium. And in fact, like I said, it's 1 in 10,000 in the interstellar medium, but calculations done by my advisor prior to my arriving at the research program showed that there is a relative abundance between carbon monoxide and molecular hydrogen much closer to on the order of 1 in 20. Now, 1 in 20 is significantly greater than 1 in 10,000. If you don't believe me, I've tried to illustrate this effect for you at the bottom of the screen. In either the left or right-hand plot that we have here, what we have is 100,000 molecular hydrogen green dots. And for each of these 100 molecular hydrogen green dots, there are the appropriate number of carbon monoxide blue dots based on the relative abundance under both models. So, in the primordial relative abundance case, that would be 1 in 10,000, which for 100,000 molecular hydrogen dots would account for 10 carbon monoxide dots. Now, for those of you in the back, this may not be very clear, but if you'd like, I can put this up at the end of the talk and you can come try to count these dots. I've spent a lot of time doing this. I have found 9 of the 10 blue dots. I think one of them may be hiding behind the legend, but that is neither here nor there. If you look to the collisional relative abundance case, we would have that 1 in 20 relative abundance, which for 100,000 molecular hydrogen, we would have a number around 5,000 carbon monoxide. So it's pretty clear that they are vastly more abundant in the collisional relative abundance case. Now, this does not necessarily mean anything in and of itself. However, the critical density of the collisions that populate the excited state, which is the density that you have to achieve of colliders to emitters in order to see significant amounts of radiation, is extremely low, which means there's a very high ceiling on the relative abundance affecting the amount of emission you get per amount of gas in your disks. So it turns out that in this case specifically, it is significant that you have a much higher relative abundance, and so what you would expect is you would get more emissions per unit mass of gas in your disks in the collisional relative abundance case than in the primordial relative abundance case, which again is just another effect that is going to cut down that amount of gas ultimately that you would have to be producing every year to account for the observations that have been made. Furthermore, the models put forth in these papers have been relatively simplistic because it is early work, and they have actually ignored several important details. First of all, the only colliders that have been considered that will populate the molecular hydrogen excited states have been that will populate the carbon monoxide excited states have been molecular hydrogen. And while it's true that because molecular hydrogen is so abundant in these environments, it would probably be the primary collider. However, there are other materials that will collide with carbon monoxide and populate that excited state, such as other carbon monoxide molecules and perhaps significantly electrons. So in this figure to the left of the screen, I've actually diagrammed for you the photodissociation or breaking apart of a carbon dioxide atom by high energy radiation, symbolized by this delta E. And what that produces is a free oxygen atom and a carbon monoxide molecule. That carbon monoxide molecule can then be further photodissociated into a single carbon atom and a single oxygen atom. However, at the energies where you would be seeing the photodissociation of carbon monoxide and carbon dioxide, you would also expect to have plenty of radiation at the energy necessary to photoionize carbon. And so the result of this photoionization is a C+ ion and a free electron. Now what this means is that in these debris clouds where you're seeing enough radiation to photodissociate carbon monoxide and carbon dioxide molecules, you would also expect to see a relatively substantial population of free electrons that are then able to move throughout the cloud, collide with carbon monoxide, and populate that excited state, which will ultimately de-excite, producing more emissions. Furthermore, the early models did not include the potential effects of shielding. If you're unfamiliar with the term shielding, I've diagrammed it for you here at the bottom. What you have is a cloud of material in interstellar space, subject to incoming radiation from some light source. In our case, it would be the host star. So in the outer regions of these clouds, what you get is photoionization or photodissociation, depending on the system that you're talking about. However, as you move deeper and deeper into the cloud, what you expect to see is that this material is shaded or shielded by the material exterior to it. And so the rate at which photoionization or photodissociation is occurring decreases the deeper you go into this cloud. Now, at a certain point, you will get to a layer called the equilibrium layer. And at this point, you actually expect to see the same number of recombinations occurring between constituent particles as you expect to see photoionizations or photodissociation. So you don't get any net gain or loss of molecules at this equilibrium layer, and thus any region interior to this equilibrium layer constitutes a shielded region, a region where you would not expect to see photodissociation occurring, but a region where you would still expect to be getting collisions and thus carbon monoxide emissions. And so potential material that could shield carbon monoxide in these debris cascades would be self-shielding, so other carbon monoxide atoms, shielding from molecular hydrogen, and potentially shielding from other material as well. Cometary bodies are pretty complicated bodies. There are an abundance of materials in them. So now I've told you a little bit about the two prevailing theories and some of the assumptions that have been made in discounting one or the other of them. I will finally get around to talking about what I did this summer in modeling these disks. So this is just a brief overview, and I'll go into greater detail on each of these points in a moment, but this is what I did. I set out to simulate the line emission profiles, which I will define for you in a moment, of the disks. And I also derived a disk mass expression, the inputs for which were actually the parameters for the simulations. So then by carrying out the simulations, theoretically I would be able to calculate disk masses for the disks that I was simulating. I also calculated the destruction rate of carbon monoxide in these disks, and then having the mass from the first stage here and the destruction rate, you can actually set up a differential equation to determine the necessary production rate that will account for the observations that you make. Then once you know the amount of carbon monoxide you must be producing every year, the next logical step is to ask, well, does this collisional model account for that much production of carbon monoxide? And so to determine this, you have to actually estimate the rate at which cometary bodies in the disks are colliding per unit time. And to do this, I followed the guidance of a paper by doctors Benjamin Zuckerman and Insiok Song, written in 2012. And then, separate from the three previous points, I also developed a dust grain model, basically just a force model of dust grains that exist in the disk. And I attempted to model the spatial distribution maps of the disks. So line emission profiles. What they are is basically just a sum of flux over a velocity channel. So in these disks, of course, you have parts of the disk moving toward or away from you, even relative to the motion between the host star and our own solar system. And so if you sum up the flux coming from any one part of these disks, what you get is a line emission profile. And these are actually sort of physically counterintuitive. If you look to the peaks on the outside of the line emission profile, these actually represent the interior of the disks, which are, of course, moving the fastest toward or away from you. And toward the center where you get these dips, those are actually the exterior edges of the disks that are, of course, moving at the slowest rate relative to the motion between our two stars. And the way that I simulated these line emission profiles was using third-party software called LIME, the Line Modeling Engine. It's basically just an iterative photon propagating software, if that means anything to any of you. And this software requires three input parameters. It requires a density profile and an initial density, for which I used a radial power law, which is pretty standard in this field and in other astrophysical fields. It also requires a temperature profile and an initial temperature, again, for which I used a radial power law. And for the vertical scale, I used a vertically isothermal law, pretty standard. And I actually ran these simulations for both of the models, for the primordial genesis case and for the collisional genesis case. And so the relative abundance in the primordial case is 1 times 10 to the negative 4. That's that 1 in 10,000 that I mentioned before. And the collisional model would be 0.05, which is that 1 in 20 that I mentioned before. Oh, and this figure is from Cushball et al. 2013, by the way. Then, so in equilibrating the system, or maybe I should say in equilibrating the production, destruction, and equilibrium mass of these disks, basically, all you have to do to get the disk mass is once you have that density profile that I mentioned on the previous page and the initial density, all you have to do is integrate over the size of the disks, and that will give you the mass of gas in the disks. And this is actually only possible because these disks have been spatially resolved pretty accurately in wavelengths not related to carbon monoxide emissions. And you can actually find the radii of these disks listed in a paper by Lehman Siffrey et al. 2016, which you may have seen that name multiple times throughout the course of this talk. It was pretty central to the work that I did. Once you have the disk masses, then it's relatively simple to determine the destruction rate of carbon monoxide in these disks. All you have to do is create effective black body curves and just integrate over the photodissociative part of the curve and then basically integrate that out over the size of the disk as well. And then you have the rate at which carbon monoxide is being destroyed in your disks. So then once you have an equilibrium mass and a destruction rate, again, it is a pretty simple method of just setting up a differential equation and determining the production rate that you would have to see to account for that equilibrium mass. So, like I said before, once you know how much mass you have to be producing per year, it's time to estimate how much mass you actually can produce under the collisional model. And again, this is via the guidelines set down by Dr. Zuckerman and Song in the paper 2012, and the process basically goes as follows. You begin with the early Kuiper belt as a debris disk analog, which is a pretty safe analogy considering the early Kuiper belt is a debris disk, or I should say was a debris disk around a G-type star, our sun. And then you scale these disks, or you scale the early Kuiper belt to the disks that you're interested in using the surface density of comets in the disks, and this is just done via a power law that was described in great detail in a paper by Dr. Jack Lissauer in 1989. So then once you know the number of comets you have moving around circular orbits in these disks, it's not too difficult to estimate the collision rate between comets in the disks, and then to, of course, calculate the possible carbon monoxide production rate from that. Now, I should mention, in order to take these steps, you also have to make some assumptions, such as about the average size of comets that are involved in collisions. You have to estimate or make an assumption about the cometary CO abundance, which is to say how much of the mass in each comet either is kept up in carbon monoxide or in carbon dioxide that will later be photodissociated and will become carbon monoxide. And you have to make an assumption about the comet destruction scale, which means you have to make an assumption about each collision, how much of the mass involved in each collision is going to end up in one of these debris cascades, and thus giving off emissions that will later be observed by us. And I made these assumptions, again, just based off of the assumptions made in the paper that inspired this avenue of my work. So moving to a new section, totally separate from the previous 3 points, was the dust grain model that I created of dust grains in the disk. Now this, I believe, is a very important part of my research. Dust grains in these disks, of course, experience forces. They experience outward radiative pressure forces because they're being hit with radiation from their host star. And they also experience inward gravitational forces, or Keplerian forces, as they move around in relatively circular orbits around their host stars. And they may or may not experience drag forces, which I will come back to in a moment. Now, the reason that I believe that the dust grain model is so important is the stability of a grain of dust in any one of these disks is actually radius dependent, which is to say there is a radius below which a dust grain would theoretically be blown out of the disk by radiation pressure, and above which the dust grain would theoretically remain stably within its orbit in the debris disk. And so you can actually determine this value, which we call the grain blowout radius, because astronomers are very creative with our naming schemes. And the nice thing about the grain blowout radius, especially compared with other values in this field, is it can be determined theoretically and observationally, whereas most things in the field, it's either theoretically determined or observationally determined, and there's not a lot of overlap. Theoretically, the grain blowout radius can be determined just by setting up a basic free body diagram, more or less, which is just so you take account of all of the forces acting on the dust grain. And then you solve each of these forces in terms of the radius, and then you solve those equations for the radius, and then you have a theoretical determination of the dust grain blowout radius, which depends on things like the luminosity of the host star, for example. Now, observationally, you can actually make determinations of the grain blowout radius as well using spectral energy distribution data, which I have examples of here for you from the three disks that I worked with, again from Lehman Sifri et al. 2012. And what these plots are just plots of luminosity versus wavelength. And so you'll notice that in the single micrometer up to millimeter wavelength, what you get is a bump of luminosity. And what this bump actually comes from is from the re-radiation or the reflection of starlight from dust grains in the disk. And so then the size and shape of these bumps is actually determined by the grain blowout radius. So what you can do is you can fit the bump, as you can see they've done here. And based on the parameters that you use to make these fits, you can actually get an observational determination of the grain blowout radius. Now, historically, the theoretically determined and observationally determined grain blowout radii agree very, very well. And this is significant for my research because also historically, the theoretical determinations of the grain blowout radius assume negligible effects from drag, from gas. And of course, this is because previous to these observations, we did not believe there was any gas in these debris disks. However, under the primordial genesis case, where the gas in these disks is assumed to be left over from star formation, what we would expect to see is much stronger coupling between gas and dust, where gas and dust are co-located. And this stronger coupling would actually increase the amount of drag force that you would see from the gas on the dust. And so if you could show that the drag forces on these dust grains is actually significant enough to be observationally distinguishable in fitting your SED data, this could actually be a really good way of discounting that primordial genesis model, if indeed it is incorrect. So finally, the last thing that I did was matching data maps. This is, again, just the spatial distribution of the disks themselves. And to model them, I actually just used the same simulations that I used to get the line emission profiles. So the outputs of these simulations are actually three-dimensional data cubes where you have two axes of space and a third axis of flux. So what you can do is you can either collapse the two axes of space and convert it into a single axis of velocity, because of course the velocity of objects in a disk moving in a circle is going to be dependent on your xy coordinates, and that's what gives you those line emission profiles. However, you can also collapse the 3D data cube along the flux axis. And then you get pictures like this, where you then represent the flux using color mapping. So what you're seeing is the brighter red colors is where you're getting more emission of carbon monoxide from these disks, and the bluer colors are where you're getting fewer emission detections from these disks. Now, there are a few issues when trying to do this, such as the resolution that you're working with, both the spatial resolution of the data that you're working with and the resolution of your simulations, and the beam size of your observations. Which for those of you who are not familiar with millimeter or radio astronomy, beam size is basically equivalent to your point spread function. It's what a point would look like if you were to plot it on one of these maps. And now we'll talk more about these issues in the conclusion section of my talk. So now that you know what I did, I will tell you what I found from what I did. I was able to find the disk masses successfully. I was also able to check the production rate of carbon monoxide after determining the destruction rate and estimating the cometary collision rate in the disks. I also successfully modeled the dust grains, that physical model of the dust grains I was telling you about, and I not so successfully matched the data maps, and you'll hear more about that in a moment. So these are my simulated line emission profiles. Again, this is just flux versus velocity. I know these didn't turn out as high resolution as I had hoped. In the primordial relative abundance case, what we found is that the parameters needed to create reasonable fits to the data implied disk masses of about 1 to 10 Earth masses of gas. Now, if you remember back to that figure that I showed you early on that was divided up into quadrants, these would certainly exist within that sort of forbidden fourth quadrant. And this is just the mass in gas, and what we found is unanimously in these disks, the gas even in young disks, the gas population is significantly less massive than the dust population. Now, in the collisional relative abundance models, the parameters that provide the best fits only imply disk masses of about 1 to 5 times 10 to the negative 3, which is 1 to 5 thousandths of an Earth mass. And so, at least by disk masses, the collisional relative abundance model is strongly favored. However, this only means so much because after determining the destruction rate of carbon monoxide in these disks and estimating the collisional rate that occurs within these disks, what I found is that collisions are actually still too infrequent by about one order of magnitude. Now, my models, like the ones that came before mine, were actually also relatively simplistic, and they were mostly carried out for the sake of checking the work of my advisor because she had gone through all of these processes before I did. And they did not account for electron collisions or shielding. However, calculations done by my advisor after my research program ended found that these actually only account for about a factor of 2, which leaves still about a factor of 5 unaccounted for in trying to account for these emissions. Now, many astronomers will tilt their head and say, well, a factor of 5 is nothing, that's basically equal. But of course, if you want to make the claim that this is where the gas is coming from, you would like to be able to fully account for all of the observations that have been made. I believe that perhaps the missing piece of the puzzle here that I did not account for when scaling from the early Kuiper belt to the disks to estimate the cometary collision rate is I did not account for the spectral type of the host stars. Now this is important because, as I said before, these disks that we see carbon monoxide emissions coming from are located specifically around A and F type stars and primarily A type stars. Now the spectral type of stars is determined by their temperature and by their mass. So A and F type stars are significantly more massive than G type stars like our Sun. And so in scaling using the cometary density of the Kuiper belt, it could very well be that I actually underestimated the cometary density in the disks that I was researching, which would mean I would also have underestimated the potentially possible carbon monoxide production rate via the collisional model, especially because observations previously have shown us that disks around A and F type stars are substantially dustier than around G-type stars. But this is speculation and would require further work to actually confirm. The dust grain modeling that I did, I was able to show that the forces of drag are substantially greater in the case of the primordial scenario versus in the collisional scenario. However, this modeling, I should mention, I only actually did in about the last week of the 10-week program during which all of this research was done. So unfortunately, I did not get a lot of time to do follow-up work in that week. And so I was not able to determine whether or not the effects of drag would actually be observationally distinguishable in the spectral energy distribution data that I showed you before. However, I believe this is an excellent candidate for future research on the subject. The data map matching, you maybe see now why I had it crossed out on the introduction slide to this section. The first thing probably that you'll notice is that if you look at the data maps, which are on the left, versus the simulated maps, which are on the right, all of the simulated maps have these big gaps in the center of the disks, whereas the centers of the data maps are all filled in. Now, this does not mean that we're actually seeing emissions from these disks in those locations, and this comes down to that the beam size that I described to you before, the point spread function of these observations. So what you're seeing is not actually emissions coming from those parts of the disks. What you're seeing is the beam more or less blurring the counts around the inner edges of the disk into the center and sort of creating this pileup of counts there, sort of giving the illusion of emission where there really is none. And I can make this statement pretty confidently because observations at other wavelengths show that indeed the central regions of these disks are clear of material as far as fine dust and gas goes. So in order to actually model these disks to a point where you could actually do some error calculations, you would actually have to model this beam, which would mean you would probably have to blur the data maps, which my advisor and I discussed briefly. But in the end, really, what it came down to is that being able to match these spatial distributions of the disks would not actually tell you that much about the dynamic environments within the disks themselves, and probably wouldn't go very far to answering the question of where the gas is coming from. And furthermore, to really accurately model these disks, you have to use pretty high resolution simulations. So to get the line emission profile models that I was showing you before, you actually don't need very high simulation resolution. And so higher resolution in your simulations, of course, means more computing time. And again, it was only a 10-week program, so we had to try to optimize not only my working time, but the amount of time during which I had access to a computer. So ultimately, this is where this part of my work ended. So I will now try to make some really brief conclusions about the results I've just described to you. I have to be a good scientist here and say that after my work, it is still absolutely impossible to definitely state the origin of this gas. I cannot tell you for sure that it is collisionally produced or that it is left over from star formation, and I can't tell you that even it's not perhaps somewhere between. But what I can say is that my work certainly seems to suggest that the collisional production model is feasible, at least significantly more feasible than previous work had claimed. Of course, they claimed that it took 300 to 500 Earth masses of cometary mass being put into debris cascades a year. So actually by disk masses, the collisional model was shown in my work to be favorable, but it is still an incomplete model because, again, it does not account for that final factor of 5 of the carbon monoxide production that leads to the emissions that we see. The Grandlaw radius moving forward will probably be a very vital part of this research to anybody who decides to try and pick this up where I left off. But ultimately, these are still very recent observations and very few follow-up observations, and really very little follow-up work has been done on the original observations. Some more data and certainly more research time will be needed to finally resolve this question. Future work, I would of course love to account for the details in these models that I was unable to account for, such as the effects of shielding and collisions with other particles other than molecular hydrogen, such as electron collisions, and perhaps most importantly, the spectral type of the host stars, because that could, in the end, ultimately end up accounting for that factor of 5 discrepancy that we saw. I would actually most like to calculate the grain blowout radii using my dust grain model, and then use those grain blowout radii to create mock-up SED data to determine once and for all whether those increased effects of drag in the primordial case would be observationally distinguishable, because again, that could provide us with sort of the final nail in the coffin, so to speak, for the primordial case, again, if it is incorrect, which it may not be. And just for the sake of completion, of course, I would love to match the data maps, though. Again, this is not the most crucial part of my work. It would not ultimately tell us much as to the answer of this question, but it's always nice to finish what you're starting. So with that, I believe I've done just about everything I set out to do. I would like to say thank you to my advisors at NASA Ames, Dr. McGordy, and I would like to say thank you to my advisor here, Dr. Nate McCready. I would like to thank the SETI Institute and my colleagues there who kept me sane through a summer of working in a tiny cubicle office at NASA Ames Research Center. I would of course like to say thank you to NASA Ames Research Center for providing me with the tiny cubicle office. I would like to thank the University of Montana and my colleagues here who have provided me with years of academic and moral support. And of course, I would like to thank all of you for being here in a small room on a Friday to hear about me talk about gas in disks around stars billions of miles away. So with that, I will end my talk, and if you have any questions, I would be more than happy to attempt an answer.
Questions for Jimmy.
Don't be shy.
I'll ask you a question. So on your first graph where you had the quadrants, mm-hmm. you had different symbols. What were the different symbols?
Okay, so that's actually a great question. I get asked this usually when I show this. I didn't get asked this in my practice talk, which was surprising. So this is taken from work by Wyatt et al. In 2014. And these ones with squares, these are actually just the stars that their research focused on. It didn't actually mean anything for the purpose of the figure from my talk.
Where would your measurements under the two different accretion or gas production, I should say, scenarios put you in the study?
Sure. So like I said, under the primordial production model, they would put us at, well, you're at about 15 million years to 20 million years, depending on who you ask, is about the age of these disks. So they would be right around here. And then 1 to 10 Earth masses would be in this region, so where you see a blank when you actually take the data. And of course, under the collisional model, it was actually 10 to the negative 3 Earth masses, so they would be down here, so safely in the region where you see actual observations putting stars on this figure.
Is there a notion on this plot that that's an evolutionary sequence that we're seeing as these stars age? There's sort of an aging curve that they sort of follow the region from the upper left down into the lower.
Oh, sure, you can actually follow that back straight from here, where again, that was massive dust in the disks, and this is just the disk fraction. So not only are they losing disks, the reason that they're losing disks is not that the disks just disappear, right? They become less and less massive over time. So this plot really is showing the same thing as this plot, just in two different ways. So it's absolutely a time evolution thing.
So one could imagine, I mean, you mentioned people had talked about the transitional point between T Tauri star situations in a, which would have more gas in the disk presumably, and a premium sequence disk that would be cleaned out of gas. Being a transitional point, maybe it's a short-lived transitional point, and these objects are maybe a short-lived time in the evolution of the premium sequence star, where they pass through that little populated portion of four. It seems like that's kind of that 1 to 10 mass at that age is kind of like a transitional point there.
Sure, and that would be a good argument in favor of the primordial scenario if we were seeing gas emissions coming from disks around stars other than A and F type stars as well. Because again, if it is an intermediate stage, it wouldn't necessarily be dependent on spectral type, where you would see emissions coming from disks that are around G and K type stars as well, if you had the sensitivity, presumably. But we do have the sensitivity to observationally distinguish between T Tauri stars and these stars. So you would expect to see, in that case, that you would expect to see these disks around other types of stars as well, and we just don't know. Yeah. Which, for me, is kind of like the smoking gun that indeed it was just an observational bias that we didn't see gas before, but it is hotly contested in the field, so I'm glad there's nobody from the other side of the field. I would be sweating bullets.
So what are the spectral types of the six stars that they studied? There are two on top, maybe there would be an A or something.
Oh, from the Wyatt et al. Plot?
Yes.
I'm actually not sure. Again, I just had that plot on my talk entirely for the purpose of showing that where the populations of stars fall. I'm not sure why they were observing those stars specifically. I could send you an email or a PDF of the paper if you'd like to know more.
I would imagine that the top two are the maybe B or A, and the fourth of the below the horizontal line is maybe G or M or something?
Potentially, yeah, or they could just be older older stars. I think they were actually all four of the debris disks for similar purposes. This is there's a good chance that the smallest they would go is a G-type star, but it's unlikely. Most of these observations have been around A and F-type stars, again, just because they're more, you know, they're brighter and they're more observationally detectable, more or less.
And higher mass stars spend very, very little time with premium sequence.
Yeah.
So most premium sequence stars are going to be A through G.
Yeah. Dr. Webb?
So can you explain a little more about how that primordial drive and that kind of stuff would impact what you would observe?
Yeah,
said,
of course.
You said it's a future project.
Sure. Sure. So my understanding of the actual physics behind the coupling is relatively tenuous. It was described to me briefly by my advisor, who has a PhD in the subject, so of course is much more knowledgeable about it than I am. But what you expect is to see the strongest coupling where gas and dust are co-located in primordial disks, where both the gas and the dust have been around since star formation. So you would have really strong coupling there. Basically anywhere where there are where there's gas and dust, you would expect it. It's almost like a measure of the stickiness between them. And so then the next strongest coupling you would expect to see if one of the two was primordial and one of the two was collisional, which would be in the primordial case where we know we have a secondary population of dust and supposedly a primordial population of gas, you would still expect to see stronger coupling just because that gas would still have been present there during the production of the dust. And you would expect to see the weakest coupling and thus negligible drag forces in the case where they're both secondary, which would be the collision model, because of course they've both just been being produced in these debris clouds, so anywhere where they're co-located currently does not mean they were co-located there during the production of both or either of them. So that's why you would expect a much stronger drag case, both for one primordial and one secondary, or both of them primordial versus both of them secondary.
So in essence, it's just coupled how long they have to interact?
More or less, yeah.
Thanks.
So Jimmy, you had said, you had said that you know, we pretty much don't see these gaseous signatures from the G and K stars because they're just not quite, potentially not quite as dusty and there's not much material collisions. Is it such that the photo dissociation basically not being an issue for those stars, is it just that the prevalence of dust just scales down that quickly such that the lack of photo dissociation doesn't matter in terms of, because I would think that, you know, without the photo dissociation you'd be able to see.
Oh, so in G and K type stars,
you have
longer lived carbon monoxide.
Right.
So
right.
Ultimately, it just comes down to the fact that around G and K type stars, you just have a lot less material.
Okay.
And so that's sort of an orders of magnitude thing. Whereas from a F type star to a G type star, the amount of photodissociative flux you're getting from an F type star versus a G type star would not be even close to the effect of just the much greater effect of having more mass around.
Okay, so
it's just
a scaling.
Star. Yeah.
Gotcha.
Exoplanets are also more common around the larger stars.
Yeah, they have more material. They form from larger giant molecular clouds. When you have a really big cake, you have really big crumbs, right?
Yep.
So you can tell I haven't eaten in a while.
Any last questions for Jimmy?
Yes. Okay, just one question about the simulation that you use. That's this STARS, the Lime software, rather. What does that? And how does that simulation work? What is that?
Sure, I'd love to explain that more. I actually was hoping I could explain it more in my talk, but I only have so much time to cover so much, so I'm glad you asked. Basically, you start with the star and you give it stellar parameters like the temperature of the host star, not the spectral type. And so then it's sort of black box, so I can only give you my understanding of what the software does, but I understand a good deal of it since I had to work with it so much. And so basically what it does is it does a random walk of photons out from the host star, and so it just follows photons out, and then it does a lot of quantum mechanical computations actually based on how likely it is that those photons are, geometrically, how likely are they going to be colliding with populations of carbon monoxide, and in that case, how likely they are to hit that carbon monoxide, and it also then models the relative motions of carbon monoxide and molecular hydrogen to see how often they are colliding with each other. So in it actually does include simulations of the destruction of these molecules as well as of the production of their emissions. And so, yeah, it's basically just an iterative photon software where it just creates a bunch of phony photons and walks them out through the disk. Some of them make it all the way out of the disk. Some of them get trapped in the disk or photodissociate molecules. But more or less, that's how it works. Did that answer your question?
Yes, you've got it. That's good. I just want to know a little bit about exactly how that works.
Sure, sure.
So it's some kind of a finite element model, is that correct? Does that?
No.
Okay.
For every reason. Presumably it's a radio transfer modeling.
Yeah,
okay.
That's really all that it is, yeah. And it takes forever, by the way, so I hope you're all aware of how precious those plots that I showed you were.
All right, let's thank Jimmy again.
I'm excited to see all these slides. I set this up just so you can.